Hello friends, in this video we are going to talk about the pathophysiology of shock. So to understand the pathophysiology of shock, let us see first what is the definition of shock. Whatever be the type of the shock, we'll come to the types of the shock in some other video. Whatever be the type of the shock, whether it is due to decrease in the volume, whether it is due to cardiac disease, or whether it is due to distributive shock or obstructive shock, whatever be it, the main definition includes there will be inadequate tissue perfusion, plus this will lead to inadequate oxygen delivery to the tissues and inadequate cellular respiration and metabolism. This will lead to inadequate cellular respiration or cellular metabolism. So there will be inadequate tissue perfusion leading to inadequate cellular respiration. What happens in case of shock? Let us understand the pathophysiology. Now, in case of inadequate tissue perfusion, why there is inadequate cellular respiration? Because there is decrease in the oxygen delivery to the tissues. When there is decrease in the oxygen delivery to the tissues, this leads to hypoxia to the tissues. This leads to hypoxia in the tissues. And so the cellular respiration now will shift to anaerobic respiration. The aerobic respiration which occurs in the cells will now shift to anaerobic respiration. The anaerobic respiration does not produce that amount of ATP which is required, which is produced in aerobic respiration. So there is deficiency of ATP. So there is deficiency of ATP in the cells. So the cellular respiration is decreased. Again, the anaerobic respiration also produces lactic acid. This leads to metabolic acidosis. Now, decrease in the ATP, what will happen due to the decrease in the ATP? Let us understand this algorithm now. Due to the decrease in the ATP, various channels in the cells are dependent on the ATP, like the sodium potassium ATPase pump. The sodium potassium ATPase pump is dependent on the ATP. Now, if the ATP is decreased, these channels don't function. Now, the function of this channel is to maintain the fluid and electrolyte homeostasis within the cells. When this channel is not functioning, definitely the cells won't survive. There will be cell lysis, and also there will be lysis of the organelles. So, lysosomes will release autodigestive enzymes. There will be release of autodigestive enzymes as well. At the same time, if we consider cells to be rich in potassium, concentration of potassium is always high in cells, so there will be also increase in the potassium in the extracellular space, in the tissue space. Now also at the same time, there is not only compromise in the delivery of oxygen to the tissues, there is not only compromise in the decrease in the ATP synthesis, also there is decrease in the glucose. Because aerobic respiration decreases as well as the oxygen delivery decreases, therefore the glucose is decreased. There is also decrease in the glucose, and this leads to further decrease in the metabolism. Now, due to ischemia, let us see what happens at the microvascular level. Now, when there is ischemia, there is release of reactive oxygen species as well as that is free radicals, the release of free radicals or cytokines. When there is ischemia, there is activation of the free radicals and the reactive oxygen species. At the same time, because of this free radicals and reactive oxygen species, there is damage to the endothelial cells of the capillaries. This reactive oxygen species and the free radicals will lead to damage to the endothelial cells of the capillaries. Now, when there is damage to the endothelial cells of the capillaries, the space between the endothelial cells will increase, and now the fluid within the intravascular space will now leak into the extravascular space. The fluid in the intravascular space will now leak into the extravascular space. Now, since due to the leakage of the fluid into the extravascular space, there will be tissue edema. Due to tissue edema, there will be further aggravation of hypoxia. And if there is further hypoxia, there is further decrease in the cellular respiration. When there is hypoxia, there is further decrease in the cell respiration, and if there is further decrease in the cell respiration, there is further depletion of ATP synthesis. So that's how the vicious cycle continues in case of shock. Now let us understand in further detail. Now when there is decrease in the ATP synthesis, ATP is the energy source of the cells. So it is not only responsible for sodium potassium ATPase pump, but in general ATP is also required for maintaining the body temperature. It is also required for heat synthesis in the body. So when there is depletion of the ATP, there is at the same time there will be decrease in the body temperature. So there will be hypothermia. Body temperature will decrease. At the same time, when the body temperature decreases, the coagulation system does not work normally. Alright, when there is hypothermia, the coagulation system does not work normally. So there is coagulopathy. This coagulopathy will lead to further tissue edema, and that will lead to further hypoxia and further decrease in the ATP synthesis. So if we talk about the three main concepts in shock, first is acidosis, second is hypothermia, and third is coagulopathy. This is known as the deadly triad. So all the three concepts are important. Then why there is acidosis, why there is hypothermia, and why there is coagulopathy, and what are the consequences and how one is related to the other. That's what we have to know about the pathophysiology of shock. Now one important concept, when the ischemia starts, initially, the patient may not have any clinical manifestation. And that stage is known as occult hypoperfusion. This is the stage when the patient may not have any clinical manifestation, or rather does not have any clinical manifestation, no manifestation. So it is known as occult hypoperfusion. But why do we have to know this? Rather, how do we diagnose a patient in a stage of ischemia when there is no manifestation? So if you can detect the patient by having high index of suspicion, you can detect the patient in the stage of occult hypoperfusion by checking the blood, lactate or lactic acid level, or by MVO2. We are going to talk about MVO2 later on. So only by checking the blood lactic acid level. If you check the blood lactic acid level, you can identify the patient in the occult hypoperfusion level. Right now, if you identify the patient in the occult hypoperfusion level, then it's nice, it's good for the patient. But if the occult hypoperfusion stage lasts for more than 12 hours, or if the ischemia lasts for more than 12 hours before you identify it, and then after 12 hours, if you start the reperfusion or resuscitation, what happens? The amount of the acid, the amount of the metabolic waste, and the potassium which has been released in the local extracellular tissue, that will now enter the systemic circulation. If you start the reperfusion after 12 hours, then the metabolic waste which was collected around the tissues, and the potassium ions which were released due to cell lysis, all that will now enter the circulation. Now, which of the organs it will go to? This will commonly go to the organs which will try to excrete them. So they will go to the kidneys, and they will go to the lungs, where it will try to release the acid by the CO2. So it will go to the organs where it will try to excrete it by the kidneys and the lungs, right? Now what happens? If the reperfusion is delayed, there is more chances of metabolic waste entering into the systemic circulation and going to the organs, kidneys and the lungs. Now, if the metabolic waste goes to the organs like this, there is also chance of injury to these organs. And this phenomenon is known as ischemic reperfusion injury. Now, how do we prevent this? This is how we can to prevent this ischemic reperfusion injury. We should have a high index of clinical suspicion. Second, we should be able to identify the patient in the stage of lactic acidosis, in the stage of occult hypoperfusion by lactic acidosis, and we should try to intervene before 12 hours of ischemia. In that case, we can prevent the damage of reperfusion to the patients. This concept of ischemic reperfusion injury is very, very important. So that's about the pathophysiology of shock. We will be uploading more videos on further chapters of Bailey and Love. Stay tuned to this channel for further updates. Right? You can drop your feedback in the comment section. Thank you for watching this video.